Today, October 31st, is Judge Andrew Becroft's last day as New Zealand's Children's Commissioner. For 20 years now, he has been on the front lines of protecting and advocating for our rangatahi. Judge Andrew Becroft is with us now live. Kia ora, thank you for being with us.
Kia ora, Jack, thank you, real pleasure.
Before the break, we played a clip from when you started in the role 5 years ago. You hoped that by now New Zealand would collectively own its problem with abuse and neglect and that we would have a world-leading legislative framework on interventions. In your view, where are we? Has it happened?
Yeah, I think we've made some real progress overall. I think as a country we have owned the issue of prioritising children. We've put children first unmistakably. I'm really encouraged when you look at, say, 17-year-olds in the youth justice system, 200,000 children getting free school lunches, smoking by adults where there are children in cars banned. Yeah, I'm really pleased. There's been huge progress, but there's much more to do.
Yeah, I want to focus a little bit on a few different areas, and I'll begin with child poverty reduction. In 2017, the government announced a new ministry for child poverty reduction, and at the time, the Minister for Child Poverty Reduction said, "I want to see urgent progress in this area." Have we seen the urgent progress this problem requires?
Well, I think it really is a yes and no answer. We've got child poverty reduction targets, halving child poverty in 10 years. We're on track for that. We've had benefits linked to wages, so the gap between benefits and wages won't get any larger. We've got the free school lunch program. We've got an increase in benefits. We've got Best Start for children. There's a lot, frankly, that we would never have dreamed about 5 years ago in place. Great foundations, but there is more to do. And while we've made some small decreases and while we're on track for the 10-year halving goal, it's going to take some bold and courageous steps. And it can't just be done by incremental small steps. So. Yes, what progress we've made, but no, we've got so much more yet to do.
What sort of bold steps?
Well, it seems to me that income inequality and disadvantage is at the heart of risk and potential bad life outcomes for children. Unless we were to address that disadvantage, that income inequality, I think we're going to continue to see bad outcomes, particularly for Māori, Pacifica and disadvantaged in health, education, youth justice, corrections. I think we need to put very much on the table a national debate about increasing the tax take. Now, that's almost been an article of faith that we don't do that. But remember, back in 1938, when Michael Joseph Savage formed the welfare state, he called it applied Christianity. Others called it applied lunacy. We're going to need some real bravery to be like other countries that prioritise children, to say, do we need to look at increasing taxes? It's not all money, mind you, but that's a very good start. We need to expand free school lunches. Wouldn't it be great if we had targeted or free medical care for every child below 18, the sort of in-kind benefit? But the reality is, unless we have those sort of tough conversations, I don't think we're going to make the big breakthroughs in reducing child poverty.
And when you talk about your concerns with income inequality, do you see that as being the main problem, or is it wealth inequality? Because, of course, we have a class of New Zealanders who own the majority of homes in New Zealand. We have seen housing prices climb astronomically over the last few years.
Yeah, I think it's both and. And clearly the capital gains tax is off the table. I think that's a pity. I think in the 1990s, when we sold off state houses and didn't build new ones, we're now paying the price. I mean, beneficiaries at the turn of the century, less than a quarter of their income was on housing. Now over 50% of their income is directed towards housing. So housing's been a huge driver for child poverty, and we've got to absolutely redouble our efforts to have affordable, warm, dry homes for those who are really doing it tough. That's all part of the big, bold, courageous steps that I talk about.
In the last couple of years, oranga tamariki interventions, particularly for Māori tamariki, have been extremely controversial. You said in the past they highlighted deep systemic issues. Do you think those issues have been resolved?
They've certainly been raised and they've been accepted, and we do have a good legislative framework in place, as I hoped for when I started this role. It's not the law or the framework that is the problem, it is the practice. Because the framework allows, for instance, for bi-Māori, four-Māori approaches. And I think a revolution by devolution, transferring power and resources, that offers real hope. Bi-Māori, four-Māori approaches, I think, are the way forward, and for Oranga Tamariki to shrink, and for many social work, particularly prevention services, to be delivered by the community, at the community level. But make no mistake, the government can't opt out of the underlying responsibility to ensure children are safe. It will always be a government role to protect children in crisis situations. But they do it with Māori when it's Māori children, with the community. Look at Hastings. As soon as Māori were asked to be involved, everything changed. It would look so much different. We can do it so much better. The law's in place, the infrastructure's in place. There's a momentum, I think, a tidal wave of change in terms of delivery for children who are doing it really tough in homes and facing real risks. And I believe this time we have a second chance for a revolution, and we'll do it. I'm really confident about that.
How has this job affected you personally?
Oh, it's the sort of job that is 24/7. It's a calling. It's been one of the genuine honours of my life. It's taken me to places in New Zealand, and I've met children and young people have just been so honest and so straightforward up and down the country. I rejoice in the, often talk about the 70-20-10, 70% who really thrive and do well, 20% who struggle with adversity, 10% who are doing it really tough, chronically intergenerational. I've heard from them all. On the one hand, I'm encouraged. On the one hand, they tell me when life is tough. That's, I guess, been the hardest job, to hear particularly primary school children. A girl telling me she finds homework hard at about age 8 because she's one of a family of 13 in a two-bedroom home. Mm. And I think in New Zealand, we haven't just been negligent, we've been flat out in dereliction of duty for our children who are doing it tough. It's almost come to be accepted that it's something we live with, but it needn't be this way. We solved it for the over 65s. We had the chance now to do it for the under 18s. We blew that chance for about 30 years, and what I guess has hit me hardest is to see the result of that dereliction of duty played out in the lives of children for whom it's not their fault and for whom responsible adults could have done much better.
Of course, before your role as Children's Commissioner, you were the Principal Youth Court Judge for 15 years. So for 20 years now, you have been bombarded by first-hand accounts and experiences of some of our most vulnerable people in the most difficult of circumstances. What does that do to your spirit?
I think it's a reality check, and it's a wake-up call. And it makes me realise that the New Zealand of today isn't the New Zealand I grew up in. We are a country that's marginalised. It doesn't get me down. It doesn't overwhelm me, because I think part of the role is to hear it and see it, but not get so emotionally involved that I can't make good, incisive, analytical judgment. That's part of the role, that's part of the tension of both the judge and in this role. But heaven help me if I don't ever forget how children are doing it tough. That's one of being the standouts of our role, that we've heard from children. We've heard their voices, we've sought them out. The government's doing it now. That's terrific. We've got a world-leading child and youth wellbeing strategy, which no one knows about, looking at six domains of a child's life: health, housing, education, abuse, neglect, being connected, respected, 84 action points. If only we knew about this. That was informed by children. That's the sort of platform, the sort of architecture that I think is really going to drive change in the future. And I hope as a country we can hold each other and the government to account to deliver that, because there is hope, terrific hope. And I just hope we can grasp it and grab it as a country and drive these changes and improvements through.
Judge, when I think about all of the subjects you've considered and subjects you've advocated for over the last 5 years, there's one in particular I wanted to ask you about. I remember you made some very strong comments about the delay with which New Zealand has reckoned with the effects of fetal alcohol spectrum disorder. I just wondered if you feel any sense of optimism about change in that space, or if you think New Zealand needs to do more to reckon with the harm that alcohol causes our young people.
I don't think we've anywhere near, as a country, grasped the enormity of that issue. We see through a glass dimly about neurodiversity generally. History will judge us harshly. That is one area where we have not made the progress. We've been sitting on our hands. We've had great action plans short on action. And I urge all of us, for all we're worth, to prioritise getting the help for fetal alcohol spectrum disorder and all neurodiverse issues. That's one area where I think we're behind the rest of the world and will be judged harshly because of it.
All right. All the very best. Congratulations on finishing up, and sorry for giving you an early start on your last day in the job. That's very unfair of us. That is the outgoing Children's Commissioner, Judge Andrew Becroft.